Welcome to the expert track of our MOOC. Now that you have successfully finished the leadership track, we will delve a little deeper into the subject of Eco-DRR and EBA. This unit will give an overview on the linkages between ecosystems, humans, and disasters. These are our guiding questions. What are the interlinkages between ecosystems, natural hazards, and disasters, and how did they emerge? What are ecosystems, and how do humans interact with them? And finally, how can ecosystems mitigate disaster risk? So let's start by addressing the first question in a bit more detail. During the past decades, many efforts have been made to reduce negative impacts on the environment that have led to climate change, biodiversity loss, as well as soil and water degradation. Here we come to a crucial point, which is often not considered in decisions on disaster risk reduction. Ecosystem degradation is a significant factor that can contribute to a hazard becoming a disaster. Or, in other words, not all storms and other natural hazards need to turn into disasters. This becomes evident when we, for instance, take a look at the coastal dunes and mangroves. Extracting sand from coastal dunes for construction or destroying them for building settlements does not only mean reduced buffer function against waves and wind, but also biodiversity loss and degradation of ecosystem services such as freshwater conservation. The same applies for mangroves, which are important breeding grounds and nurseries for coastal reef fish and other marine animals. Destroying them can reduce the natural coastal protection and increase the risk of coastal erosion due to cyclones and storm surges. At the same time, local fisheries are negatively affected due to the loss of the natural fish breeding grounds. Our second question is about ecosystems and human interaction. You have already heard about ecosystems in the leadership track, and I'm sure you can give a definition. One that is frequently used is the one given by the Convention on Biological Diversity in 1992. It defines an ecosystem as a dynamic complex of plant, animal, and microorganism communities and their non-living environment, interacting as a functional unit. However, there are many other definitions, and some of them explicitly include humans as part of ecosystems. But what is our place in ecosystems? Well, according to Charles Darwin, we can consider ourselves as part of the animal community. On the other hand, our impact on ecosystem has become so strong that a new geological epoch called the Anthropocene was coined. It began with the Industrial Revolution in the late 18th century, as carbon emissions to the atmosphere increased significantly, as did plant and animal extinction rates. So, with respect to the impact on our planet, we have even become a geological factor. But even before then, human nature interactions changed during the course of human evolution. Our oldest ancestors had to rely on their environment and adapt to the natural conditions. The development of first basic tools around 2 to 3 million years ago and the controlled use of fire around 400,000 years ago can be seen as initial stages for conquering the natural environment. However, effects were rather limited due to low population density and limited geographical expansion. This is also true for the few hunter-gatherer tribes that survived into modern times. With the development of agriculture in the Middle East around 10,000 years ago, humans settled down and systematically used the land for agriculture and livestock farming. This led to a fundamental land cover change in many regions of the world. It was also the trigger for urbanization and population growth. The next stage of human-nature interaction started with the Industrial Revolution. It is characterized by massive environmental degradation at the global scale. But at the same time, we are experiencing the highest life expectancies and living standards in human history, at least for the majority of the world's population. Therefore, it is important that we respect and manage nature to secure and protect human well-being. Let's finally come to the last question of this unit. How can ecosystems mitigate disaster risk? As discussed briefly in the leadership track, Eco-DRR is one of the few approaches that can reduce all three components of the disaster risk equation. Do you remember what they are? If you answered exposure, vulnerability, and hazards, then you got it right. We consider that ecosystems reduce exposure in certain cases, for example along coastlines, where green belts act as natural buffers. Ecosystems reduce vulnerability as they provide many ecosystem services for supporting livelihoods and human well-being. Last, healthy ecosystems can reduce the impact of hazards by acting as natural buffers. Here are a few examples. Mountain forest and vegetation on hillsides can reduce the risk of landslides, rockfall, avalanches, and soil erosion. Moreover, forests store water and can reduce the runoff after rainfall events. Thereby, they can reduce the risk of floods and droughts. Wetlands and riverine ecosystems are important for flood control, as they store water and slowly release it, reducing speed and volume of runoff. Coastal wetlands, tidal flats, deltas, and estuaries can reduce the height and speed of storm surges and tidal waves. Coastal ecosystems such as coral reefs, salt marshes, mangroves, and sand dunes can serve as natural buffers against tropical cyclones, storm surges, flooding, other coastal hazards, and to some extent, tsunamis. Moreover, coastal wetlands buffer against saltwater intrusion and adapt to sea level rise. Dryland ecosystems can reduce the risk of drought and desertification, as trees, grasses, and shrubs conserve soil and retain moisture. Shelter belts, green belts, and other types of living fences act as barriers against wind erosion and sandstorms. We close this unit with two key messages. One, healthy ecosystems are more effective in protecting against hazards. And two, depending on the magnitude of the hazards, there are limitations to how much protections ecosystems can provide, just as there are limitations to engineered structures. As you see, environmental issues are of particular importance when we consider how to reduce disasters. I hope you enjoyed this unit, and please don't forget to take the exercise that goes with this unit.